Welcome to Elements of Mechanical Engineering, Module 1, that is Source of Energy. We are moving forward. Today we have to discuss one of the important renewable energy. It's nothing but wind energy. Harnessing of wind energy is to generate mechanical power. So once you get the mechanical power, easily you can convert into electric power with the help of turbine and generator. So that is one of the important concept, because we have to harvest energy for future generation, because you know what are the important demerits of petroleum based fuel, such as diesel or petrol. If you use that one, so there will be a lot of disadvantage side to the atmosphere. One of the important environmental issue is global warming, so you have to avoid as much as possible. So for that reason, we have to find alternative fuel. So wind energy plays one of the important alternative fuel. So today we have to study one of the important turbine, so that is wind turbine, or we call it as windmill for generating electricity. So we already discussed solar energy, that is one of the major source of energy. Similarly, today we are going to study wind energy. Then after that we have to study hydel, so nothing but a water source. We can develop electricity with the help of water. Similarly, we have to study one more energy, that is nuclear energy. So we have to know about which are the nuclear fuels. So coming to the wind power, so you know how wind energy is created. So wind energy is always created because of sun. When the atmosphere is heated, what will happen? So some patches of air become warmer than other patches of air. So then the whatever the warmer patches of air rise, so that will replace the colder one. So that's why the replacement is nothing but wind blows. So because of wind, we have to produce power, so that is with the help of turbine. So you know the turbine is nothing but a rotating element, so that can be used to develop the power. So when a wind strikes the turbine, so turbine starts rotating, so you'll get a mechanical power. So once you get the mechanical power, so easily you can convert into electrical power with the help of generator. So this is the basic concept for any power plant, because already we discussed about a steam power plant or hydraulic turbines. We already discussed in the second module. So similar to that one, we have to study today wind turbine, or we call it as wind mill. Those both names are same, but only changes in the working fluid, because in water turbine we used water as the working medium, so that will strike the blade. But here the wind will strike the blade. Similarly, in the steam power plant, this whatever the steam generated, so that will strike the blade. So blade is one of the important component of any turbine. So usually here the number of blades will be usually less in the wind turbine. It's around 2 or 3, and this can be used to convert the kinetic energy of the wind to mechanical energy, because rotary engine, you know, in which kinetic energy of a moving fluid is converted into mechanical energy. So by causing the rotation of the rotor, so the whatever the concept, that will be same as a fan, because only the concept remains same, but whatever the working principle remain different, because it is exactly opposite, because the fan is used there you are going to absorb the power. You are not going to develop the power, because whatever the electric energy, so that will convert into mechanical energy. Mechanical energy means the rotation of the fan. So thereby you are getting wind. So that is what air you will get. So for your comfort. So that is the fan, working of fan. So that working is exactly opposite to the wind turbine. Wind turbine means here the rotation of the blade with the help of kinetic energy of the moving fluid. So fluid is nothing but here wind. So because of that one, the shaft will rotate, because the shaft is coupled with blade. The shaft will rotate. So if you connect that shaft to generator, so generator will is nothing but electrical device. Generator is always convert mechanical energy into electric energy, because generator is always made up of rotor and stator. So stator is nothing but a coil, and rotor is nothing but magnet. Because of this magnetic field, the flow of electrons takes place. It's nothing but current. So this way you can generate electricity. So that is about wind turbine. So this we have to install at the high altitude. We can say around more than 80 to 90 meters height. So then if the height is more, means you will get the more amount of wind. It means that you can produce a more amount of power. So that is about wind turbine. So working is very simple. When the wind strikes the blade, because of one of the important effect, aerodynamic effect, because whatever the blade, so that is in the aerofoil structure. So because of drag and lift, because of low pressure, air forms on the one side of the blade. So that will pulls the blade towards it. So causing the rotor will rotate. So that is the one of the basic principle behind aerofoil structure. So because of lift and drag phenomena, the rotor start rotates at lower RPM. So whatever the speed of rotation of this rotor will be very less. So we have to convert whatever the low speed rotation to high speed rotation. So that is with the help of one gearbox. You can see here gearbox, that is nothing but you have to increase the speed. So that is possible if you mesh the gear of different teeth. So the low speed driving shaft is connected to the one of the gear, and high speed driving shaft you have to connect to the another gear of different teeth. So that you have to decide. So usually whatever the speed at the lower side, so that is around 16 to 18 RPM. So 16 to 18 RPM speed you have to convert into high. So around the speed ratio, that will be gear ratio, is of 100. It means that whatever the speed at the higher side, that will be around 1800 revolution per minute. So that is the allows the turbine generator to produce alternate current electricity. It's nothing but AC electricity. So here you can see one of the enclosures. So this enclosure we call it as nacelle. So nacelle is nothing but it houses for key turbine elements. Which are the important turbine elements? It's nothing but gears, rotor and generator. So gears, rotor and generator. So that we have to provide one enclosure. That enclosure we call it as nacelle. So that is one of the important component of any wind turbine. So another important component of any turbines, that is turbines control. Because not shown here. So that also very important. So that controls the whatever the speed, because that will regularly check the speed when if the speed of the rotor that exist critical value, say around 55 meter per hour. So that means avoid the damage, because if exceed that speed, so there will be a damage because of high winds. So that will be damage entire windmill. So if damage means, again there will be a loss, because whatever the installation cost will be very high for any windmill or wind turbine. So that's why we have to take a precaution. So the important component is turbine's controller. So that will control the rotor speed. For that purpose, we have to use we have to measure what is the speed of the wind. You know, that can be measured with the help of one device or one meter. So that meter is called it as anemometer. So anemometer is nothing but which will measure wind speed and transmit the data to the controller, because controller will check the, it will measure the whatever the it will take the action based on whatever the measurement of the speed. If speed exceeds more than 55 meter per hour, so it means that it leads to damage. So that's why it will pass the signal. So that is the main function of turbine's controller. And there also one more important component, that is brake. It is also housed in the nacelle, because it stops the rotor mechanically or electrically or hydraulically during emergencies. Because sometime if you want to stop the turbine blade, so easily you cannot stop that one. So for that reason you have to go for brake. So that brake can be operated either by mechanically or electrically or hydraulically. So that can be used during emergency. So this is about wind turbine. So there will be two important types of turbine based on its axis. One is called horizontal axis wind turbine, another one is called vertical axis turbine. So majority of wind turbines have a horizontal axis turbine. You can see here one of the video on wind turbine.
Wind energy is becoming very popular with the growth of clean energy. It is a reliable source of power for a significant percentage of the population that has limited or no access to grid electricity. For a planet already suffering from the effects of climate change and environmental pollution, wind energy can be a green and clean solution. Let's understand how a wind turbine produces electricity. But first, do you know what is wind energy? Simply put, wind is moving air that contains kinetic energy, and the wind turbine converts this kinetic energy into electricity. A wind turbine's most prominent components are its blades. Most turbines usually have either two or three blades. The hub and the blades together form the rotor, while the main body of the turbine sitting on top of the tower and behind the rotor is called the nacelle. Inside the nacelle is the heart of the turbine, which consists of the low-speed drive shaft, the gearbox, the high-speed drive shaft, the generator, and the wind charge controller. Behind the nacelle is the anemometer, a device that measures the wind speed, and the wind vane, which measures the wind direction and orients the turbine accordingly so that the blades face directly into the oncoming wind and captures the maximum amount of energy. When the wind hits the blades, they get lifted and rotate around the central hub. In most large modern turbines, the blades can swivel on the hub at the front so they can meet the wind at the best angle. As the blades rotate, the rotor spins, capturing the kinetic energy from the wind, and this turns the low-speed drive shaft, which rotates at a slow speed of 10 to 60 revolutions per minute. For large turbines, the speed is much too low to produce electricity, and hence it is necessary to increase the turning speed of the low speed shaft, which is done by the gearbox. Smaller wind turbines that operate at lower wind speeds to generate small amounts of power do not need a gearbox. These are called direct drive systems and are usually less than 10 kW in capacity. When present, the gearbox is used to raise the speed of the high-speed drive shaft by over 100 times, which rotates at about 1500 revolutions per minute. The high-speed shaft is connected to a generator which converts the kinetic energy from the spinning shaft into electricity. The electricity produced is in the form of wild alternating current, which is unusable in this form because of highly variable voltage and frequency. The wind charge controller smoothens or stabilizes the alternating current and converts it into direct current. The direct current produced then flows through a cable running down through the inside of the turbine tower and is connected to an inverter, which again converts it into usable alternating current. Wind power is one of the lowest priced renewable energy technologies available today. The average lifetime of a wind turbine is about 15 to 20 years. Wind turbines can be built on existing farms. The produced electricity can be used locally, fed into a local substation, power grid, or to nearby buildings and communities. This is how wind energy is used to light cities, villages, industries in a clean and sustainable way.
Some of the important advantage, and that is nothing but if you use wind power, so that leads to environmental benefits, because there is no any harmful gases to the environment, because whatever the pollution that comes from petroleum based fuel, so that you can eliminate if you use this type of power. So it means that the global warming, so that you can avoid if you use wind energy. And based on economic development of our country, so that also more important if you use this type of fuel. And you can conserve this type of fuel, because if you use non-renewable energy sources, that will deplete day by day. So if you use this type of fuel, you can conserve. And one of the fuel cost that is freely available, so that's why you can recommend this type of power for future generation. So these are the some of the important advantage, along with this you can install anywhere, because whatever the land below this plant or below this turbine, you can use it for agriculture or any other farming activities, because that will not cover entire space. Because if you use some other energy sources such as solar panel and all, so that will consume more space. So that can be avoided if you use a wind turbine. So that is one of the important advantage, along with the, as I mentioned, there is no any greenhouse gases, because as we discussed already, so this is one of the eco-friendly energy for future generation. And coming to the disadvantage. A disadvantage is, one of the major disadvantage is whatever the strength of the wind is not constant, means so whatever the amount of electricity, so that also will not get at a constant rate. So the wind is very important. It means that there should be a wind movement, so that we have to find where the wind speed is more. That place only you have to install this type of power plant. And one more thing is it produces noise, and So that will be a problem, not the important thing. Continuous noise will come. So, and that leads to harmful to the animals or ecosystem. So these are the some of the disadvantage. The installation cost is somewhat high for initial investment, and because whatever the diameter of the blade or whatever the tower needed, so that leads to cost. But anyhow, the whatever the fuel is nothing but wind, so that is available cheaply. And one more thing, one of the disadvantage, whatever the efficiency is very less compared to petroleum based fuel. So we can say efficiency is around 20 to 50%, but it is more than enough because there is no any pollution to the surrounding. At the same time, there is no any cost for fuel. So that is one of the disadvantage side, but that also we consider as advantage if you use this type of energy. So this is about wind turbine. So next we'll move towards one more power source, that is nothing but hydro power plant. It's also called Heidel power plant. So that is nothing but, we already discussed this one, hydro power plant. Now this is about construction of a hydro power plant. So you can see, so this can be used for generating electricity. So it's also called as water turbine. With the help of a water turbine, we have to generate electricity. So from the working medium as water, because in windmill we used wind as a working medium, but here working medium is water, and concept remain same. Instead of wind energy, here we have to convert hydraulic energy. It's nothing but kinetic energy of the water. We have to convert into mechanical energy. It's nothing but rotation of the shaft. From mechanical energy to, we have to convert into electric energy with the help of generator. So that is nothing but electrical device. So then you will get electric power or electricity. So that is the main principle behind hydro power plant. It is also called Heidel power plant. For this purpose, we have to go for some of the construction. So main construction is, it requires dam. So dam you have to construct across the reservoir. So reservoir is nothing but it is the source of water. So we have to construct dam at a certain height, because dam, you know what is the function, it will store the water. It means that whatever the potential energy, so that is based on the height of the dam. If the if it is stores at a higher height, the when the head is more, means the potential energy of the water is high. So potential energy we have to convert into kinetic energy of the water through one more element. So that element is called penstock. The penstock is always connected to the dam to turbine. So that is nothing but penstock. It is nothing but pipe. So penstock is nothing but so one of the important elements, nothing but pipe, that is between the surge tank and prime mover. So prime mover is nothing but turbine. So and there is one more tank that is not shown here. So it's nothing but surge tank. So I'll explain later what is the important of that surge tank. The structural design of penstock is same as pipe, except for that it's made up of a stronger inside to withstand high pressure, because high pressure is caused by the water hammer during the load fluctuation. Because whatever the reservoir, so that is whatever the water stored inside the dam, it's having a high pressure. So when it is released through the gate, So penstock always withstand this high pressure, otherwise there will be a bursting of pipe takes place. So that's why that will made usually stronger inside. So the penstock are always equipped with the gates at the inlet, which can be closed during the repair of the penstock. So that is about penstock. You know already what is the function of dam. The dam is used to increase the height of water level behind it, and you can increase the reservoir capacity. So that is because dam helps to increase the working head of the power plant, because whatever the power output is depend on the power input. So power input is nothing but hydraulic power. So hydraulic power, you already know what is the equation, that is rho g q h. It's nothing but water input. So water input we have to convert into water output. So that is nothing but shaft power. So that is about dam. Then here you can see that is one of the main thing, wall house, and here a power house. So wall house for controlling the water level. To the water always strike the rotor. So rotor is nothing but turbine. So that turbine is called water turbine. So there will be different types of turbine based on head available. So based on head available means if the water level is head available is low, then we call it as low head turbine. If the water head is high, then we call it as high head turbine. Similarly, if the water head available is high, then we call it as high head. Similarly, if the water head is medium, we call it as medium head power plant. Similarly, based on the flow of the water also, we can classify turbine. You already studied that one, axial turbine, radial turbine, and tangential turbine. So there will be three important turbines, you know, based on different classification. The one is Kaplan turbine, second one is Francis turbine, and the third one is Pelton turbine. So Pelton turbine is nothing but it's a impulse turbine. Another one is reaction turbine. So these are the different classification of turbine. So you can use based on head available. Similarly, based on flow of water, you can use particular turbine for particular application. As you know, turbine is always like having a rotor. It is connected with the blades and it is coupled with the shaft. So when water strike the blade, so the blade starts rotating. So whatever the kinetic energy, so that will convert into mechanical energy of the shaft, because the shaft starts rotates. It means that the kinetic energy of the water, so that will convert into mechanical energy. So that shaft is coupled with the generator. So generator also start rotating, because generator having rotor as well as stator. Stator is nothing but coil. So because of strong magnetic field between the rotation of the coil, so it will produce alternating current. So that will supplies to the transmission line, to the power grid. So you can store and you can use it for different application. So you can see here one more function, that is you have a tail race. The main function of tail race and draft tube also using in most of the turbine. It's a structure that serve for two purpose. One is main, so the turbine to be set above the tail water level without loss of head to facilitate inspection and maintenance. For easily you can inspect inspection you can do, and at the same time maintenance also. So that's why the whatever the turbine, so that will place above the tail race. Tail race is nothing but the level of the water, so that you can install. So that is one of the important function of draft tube, and it supplements the action of the runner by utilizing the most of the remaining kinetic energy of the water at the discharge end of the runner, or we can say outlet of the runner. So that is the important function of draft tube. So usually made up of increasing in cross section. So that is about one of the important device, because that is not shown in here. So it is always connected to the outlet of the turbine, because already we discussed in the hydraulic turbine. And one more important thing, that is surge tank. So surge tank is a small reservoir in which water rises or falls to reduce the pressure swing, so that they are not transmitted to the penstock. Otherwise there will be damage to the penstock. So that effect, what is the effect, is called water hammering effect. So that is due to that you can avoid with the help of surge tank. So that is the main function of surge tank. So water hammering effect is nothing but when there is a sudden close or decrease in pressure due to control valve, then there will be a backflow of water. So this creates high pressure zone in the penstock. So due to high pressure, what will happen, the penstock may burst. So that effect we called it as water hammering effect. So in order to avoid that effect, a small tank is attached to the penstock which stores water in it, and this tank is called surge tank. So usually the location is here, it is connected to the penstock. Working is very simple. As you know, initially water of the river is in some catchment area, so that area we call it as catchment area. From catchment area, water flows to the reservoir, to the dam. So you can see here, so at the dam water get accumulated, thus the potential energy of the water increases, because always potential energy is with respect to position. So it's nothing but height of the dam. So when the gate of the dam are open, then the water moves with the high kinetic energy into penstock. So through penstock water goes to the turbine, and water strikes the turbine. So since the penstock makes water to flow from high altitude to low altitude, this kinetic energy of the water is again increased. So because of this, the turbine starts rotates. So because of this, what will happen, the rotation of the shaft will takes place. The shaft is nothing but whatever the power you will get, that is nothing but shaft power. So once you get the shaft power, then easily you can convert into, shaft power is always of mechanical nature, that you can convert into electric form with the help of generator. So that is mean working of hydropower. Once you get electric power, so electric power is nothing but electricity, so that you can use for various application, similarly our day-to-day application. So now we have to know what are the advantage of this power plant, or this power that is nothing but hydropower. So no fuel charge, because it is one of the renewable energy sources. So that's why no fuel charge, because if you use petrol, diesel, so we have to pay charges for fuel. but this is cheaply available. It means that maintenance operation charge very low for this type of power plant. And one more thing, whatever the supervising staffs means labors are less required for this power plant. And coming to the plant efficiency, so plant efficiency does not changes with age, because once you make the dam and all, if you construct properly, so if sufficient water is stored, means whatever the power you'll get, that will be more, and efficiency will be more in that case, and it will not decrease day by day, because the same efficiency you can maintain for longer period of time. So, and no fuel transportation is required, because in other power plants, so we have to diesel power plant, we have to transport a fuel from one place to another place, so that also a problem in if you use non-renewable energy sources, that is mainly a coal. If you use thermal power plant, if you use coal, then you have to transport from one place to another place. And here there is no ash or any flue gas problem, so it means does not pollute the atmosphere, because atmosphere pollution is not there if you go for this type of energy sources. And whatever the plants, that also can be used for flood control, because you are using dam here, so it means that you can control flood. Similarly, you can use this type of power plant for irrigation purpose also. Whatever the water stored here, so that can be used for irrigation purpose also. So life of this is somewhat high with compared with some other power plant. So that is about hydro power plant, some of the advantage. Now coming to the disadvantage side, the initial cost of the power plant is very high, because we have to install this one, you have to construct the dam, so you know how to construct a dam, because it will take a long time, so that's why. And the construction should be perfect also, because there should not be any crack during the otherwise there will be a chance of flood. So that also one of the major disadvantage of hydro power plant, because the construction of the dam should be perfect. And and one of the major disadvantages, the water, because water source is due to rain only during summer season, so this plant will not work, because the water has to store. So this depends on the natural phenomenon of rain. So these are the some of the disadvantage. And one more disadvantage is, because usually such plant is located in hill areas, that will be away from the load center. Load center is nothing but, so whatever the required power is required, so that center, so that will be very far away from the load center. So for that reason we have to require long transmission lines. So if you provide long transmission lines, some of the power may loss, so you will not get more amount of power for your particular application. So that is the one more disadvantage of hydro power plant. So this is one more diagram, so you can see here. Similarly, this one. Now we can see one more video on this topic, that is hydro power plant.
Hydroelectric power plant. In a hydroelectric power plant, electricity is produced from water. A dam is built across a large river to hold back the river water and raise its level to form a reservoir. At the bottom of the dam, there is a floodgate. Water flows through the penstock and rotates the turbine. The flowing water rotates the turbine, which is placed at the end of the penstock. The turbine, in turn, rotates the shaft that is connected to the coils of a generator. These coils are placed in between strong magnetic poles. The rotating shaft turns the coils. The change in magnetic field due to the movement of the coils results in electric current.
So, next type of energy source, that is nuclear power. So, nuclear power is nothing but one of the non-renewable energy sources. So, but as compared with the petroleum-based energy sources, this is a clean energy source. That's why you can utilize for and it acts as a eco-friendly energy sources. And here you will get energy from the reaction that is called a nuclear reaction. So there will be two different types of reaction. One is called nuclear fission and one more is called nuclear fusion. So nuclear fission means the splitting of heavy nucleus, because whatever the power that is generated utilizing the energy in the nucleus of an atom, because we have to use here atom. And during the reaction, so a lot of heat is generated in the form of energy, so that is in the form of heat. So the small amount of fuel in the sense whatever the nuclear fuel, so it's nothing but uranium-235, we are going to commonly used nuclear fuel. So whatever the heat, so that will be generated, so that is equivalent to if you burn around a metric ton of coal, around we can say 1500 ton of coal, if you burn whatever the heat generate, that will equal to if you burn 1 kg of uranium. So that is equivalent, nearly equivalent. So that's why this can be one of the important energy source, because for transportation, because if you carry that much of coal and all, it will require a lot of cost for transportation. So you can avoid if you go for nuclear fuel, because whatever the amount of heat so generated, that is very high. So that is called nuclear fission. Nuclear fission is nothing but splitting of heavy nucleus, and a lot of power is generated. And one more reaction is called nuclear fusion. Nuclear fusion is nothing but joining of lighter nucleus, so that is called nuclear fusion. So nuclear energy is always energy trapped inside each atom. So heavy atoms are unstable and undergo nuclear reaction. Now we'll see what do you mean by a nuclear reaction. When a neutron is bombarded into uranium-235 atom, so it will split into smaller nuclei. You can see here smaller nuclei. So and it will release a lot of energy. So that is nothing but bombardment. So if you do again this one, whatever the lighter element, if you again bombard with the help of a neutron, so it will again split and again it will release the heat. So that is nothing but chain reaction. So it will produce chain reaction. So because of chain reaction, so lot of heat is generated, because 1 into 2, then similarly 2 into 4, 4 into 8, likewise there will be a chain reaction. So because of chain reaction, so lot of heat is generated. So that heat you have to convert into steam. So if you supply water, so with the help of that heat, you can generate steam. So now you can strike that steam over the turbine. So that is nothing but steam turbine. So turbine starts rotating, because whatever the heat energy, so that will convert into mechanical energy through steam. So thus the turbine starts rotating. So if the turbine shaft is coupled with the generator, so you can generate electricity. So that is the main working of nuclear power plant. You can see here, this is nothing but a chain reaction. So the bombardment of neutron takes place, and the splitting of nucleus takes place, and during splitting that reaction will be nuclear fission, and a lot of heat is generated. Now we'll see how the nuclear power plant will work. So how you can convert nuclear energy into electrical energy. So that is with the help of nuclear power plant. Before that, we have to see what are the important parts or important accessories required for this nuclear plant in order to produce electric power. So that is some of the important are steam generator, a reactor, control rods, reflector, reflector, then shielding, reactor vessel, heat exchanger, a coolant, turbine, condenser, generator, a cooling tower, and water treatment chamber. So some of the important then one more, nuclear fuel. So first one is nuclear fuel. We have to know which is the fuel used. So one of the most important fuel used in the nuclear power plant are uranium 235. So that is commonly used. Similarly, uranium 230, sorry, thorium 232 and uranium 235. These are the commonly used nuclear fuel. And the fuel is required in nuclear power plant to produce huge amount of heat energy. The fuel are inserted in the fuel rod. So you can see here inside this reactor, there will be a fuel rod. So fuel rods, fuels up we have to insert in the form of capsules, or in the form of a capsule you have to insert inside the fuel rod. So these fuel rods are bombarded with the slow moving neutrons. So if you bombard with the slow moving neutrons, so there will be a separate provision we have to provide for the bombarded or hit the neutron to the fuel rod. So this device we known as neutron bombardment device. So that is inside this reactor. So that is about nuclear fuel. Then one more important element, so that is nothing but moderator. So we have to use a moderator in the reactor. So you can see this is nothing but reactor. So what is the function of moderator? So moderator is used to reduce the kinetic energy of the fast neutron into slow neutron. So and it will increase the probability of the chain reaction. So that is the main function of moderator. The commonly used moderator are graphite, heavy water, and beryllium. So are generally used moderator in the reactor. So this is about moderator. And one more thing, that is control rods. So control rod, the main function of control rod is to regulate the rate of chain reaction, because whatever the chain reaction inside this reactor, so that we have to regulate with the help of control rod. For that purpose, so the control rod will absorb whatever the neutrons Thus, it will regulate the chain reaction. So usually the control rod is made up of boron or cadmium materials, which will absorb always neutrons. So that is about control rod. You know already the atom consists of a nucleus and nucleus. So nucleus is nothing but proton and neutron. So and the electron is surrounded at the orbit. So this is about control rod. And coming to the fuel rod, so that is not mentioned here. Inside this reactor, between the control rod and moderator, so there will be a one more rod that is called a fuel rod. It's like tube-like structures, so that containing nuclear fuel. So nuclear fuel are made in the form of capsules, and we have to insert in the tube. So during the nuclear reaction, nuclear fuel will release the energy to produce power. So that is about a fuel rod. Then coolants are used. So coolants are used to cool the reactor by carrying away the heat generated by the reactor, because a lot of heat is generated inside this reactor. So you have to carry away whatever the heat, and that heat can be used to convert the water into steam, because we have to generate here steam. So once you generate the steam, then the rest of the working is similar to steam turbine. So there are many number of coolants are used. Some of the main coolants are water, heavy water, then carbon dioxide, liquid sodium, organic liquid, so etc. We can use as a coolant. So the coolant should have high latent heat of absorption. So the cheaply available coolant are water. So water is frequently used a coolant in the nuclear power plant. Then coming to the reflector, you can see here the reflector is nothing but main function of a reflector is to minimize the neutron leakage by reflecting them into the reactor. So whatever the neutrons should not leak from the system. So that's why we have to use a reflector. The main function of the reflector is to reflect whatever the neutron back into a reactor. So for that reason, the graphite or beryllium are generally used as a reflector in the nuclear power plant. So main properties of a good reflector materials, so should have a good thermal conductivity, and should have good corrosion resistance, and whatever the stability should be very high under high temperature and high pressure condition. It should not absorb neutron, so it should have good reflectivity. So then only such material we have to use. The commonly used materials are graphite and beryllium for this purpose. So this is about reflector. So these are some of the important parts of a nuclear power plant, that is in the nuclear reactor side, inside the nuclear reactor. Now coming to the turbine. So you know what is the function of a turbine. So turbine is nothing but a rotating thing, so that will always convert whatever the energy, so that will get from the steam, so that will convert into the shaft power. The shaft power, shaft is connected to the generator. The generator is nothing but electrical device, so that will convert mechanical power into electric power, so that can be used for electricity for various application. And the function of a condenser is to condense the whatever the steam back into liquid. So that is the main function of condenser. And now coming to the working of nuclear power plant. So working is very simple, because in the reactor inside, so what will happen, the nuclear fission takes place. The commonly used fuel is uranium-235. So because of bombardment of the neutron, so there will be chain reaction. Because of chain reaction, the lot of heat is generated. So that heat we have to carry with the help of water. So we have to supply water into the reactor. So what will happen? So it will carry the heat along with the water. So that will comes to the steam generator. The steam generator is nothing but one type of heat exchanger, or we call it as boiler. Inside this, what will happen? Whatever the water, so that will convert into the steam. So that steam is nothing but steam. We have to use it for turbine to run. So if turbine runs, you'll get rotation of the turbine leads to a mechanical power, is nothing but shaft power. So once you get the shaft power, you can connect it to generator, so that you'll get electric power. So that is the one cycle. And again, you can see the steam, whatever the steam coming from the steam generator or boiler, so that will strike the turbine. So after this, what will happen? If you condense that one, whatever the steam, whatever the after condensation, so again you'll get water. So that water, you can pump it again to the steam generator, because the water will heat, because of the heat, whatever the heat you'll get from the reactor, the same heat you can utilize, and the water again converts into vapor form, that is a vapor state. So then again it will convert into steam. The cycle will repeat. The same water also you can use it for to carry the heat from the reactor. So this is like a cyclic process. And you have one more tower here, cooling tower. So main function of cooling tower is to cool the water, so at the normal temperature. So that is the main function of cooling tower. So cooling towers are used to convert the hot water or steam exhausted from the turbine into normal water. So that is the main function of cooling water. Similarly, the condenser always receives an exhaust hot steam from the turbine. So with the help of water, it is cooled. So water taken from the available source, such as river or filter water in the treatment plant. So this water again recirculated to the heat exchanger through feed water pump. So that is again you can use whatever the same water, you can recirculate to the heat exchanger or steam generator. So that is the working of nuclear power plant. The main working is whatever the heat energy is converted into electric energy. Coming to the advantage of nuclear power plant, because nuclear power plant station occupies a smaller space compared to other conventional power station of same capacity. This is one of the advantage. Then this station does not require plenty of water, hence it is not essential to construct a plant near to a natural source of water, because hydropower plant means it requires a lot of water. For this station, the whatever the amount of water is less. And one more advantage is this power plant does not require huge quantity of fuel, because 1 kg of uranium produce heat which is equivalent to 4300 tons of coal, as we mentioned, nearly, not exactly 4000, nearly 4000 tons of coal. And one more advantage is it is possible to locate plant near the load center, wherever power required. So there only you can install this type of nuclear power plant. But in case of wind turbine and hydropower plant, this cannot be possible, because wherever river source is there only you have to install. So that is the one more advantage. And clean operation, because there is no any ash content or flue gases, so that's why it's a clean operation. So area required is very less compared with the other type of power plant. And this is independent of geographical condition. This And one more advantage is saving of natural resources such as coal, oil, gas. You can save if you use this type of power plant. Now coming to the disadvantage. So it has some of the disadvantage. The main disadvantage is the fuel cost is fuel is not easily available. You know, the uranium-235 is a rarely available radioactive fuel, so that is not easily available, and the cost of this fuel is also very high. And one more disadvantage is initial cost for constructing nuclear power station is very high. So cost of the initial investment is very high for this power plant. And one more this, the whatever the fission byproduct is radioactive in nature, so it may cause high radioactive pollution. So that is one of the major disadvantage. So radioactive pollution, so that is very dangerous to the human, at the same time for atmosphere. So this is one of the major disadvantage of nuclear power plant. So these are the some of the disadvantage, because to handle this trained persons are required, because the whatever the uranium, then nuclear reactor, so experienced peoples are required to handle this type of power plant. And one more disadvantage is the maintenance cost is very high, and whatever the waste disposal, because whatever the fuel, the uranium, so that is highly dangerous to the human health. That waste disposal is problematic, and construction is somewhat complex compared with the other type of power plant. So these are the some of the disadvantage. So this is about nuclear plant. Thank you. We'll see one more video on nuclear power plant, how the construction and operation will be.
Nuclear power plants are thermal power stations which generate electrical energy from heat. They consist of numerous buildings and facilities, the most important of which are as follows. The turbine building houses several turbines as well as the generator necessary for electrical power generation. The containment building where the nuclear reactor is housed is made of meter-thick reinforced concrete. Inside this building, nuclear reactions take place where water is heated up. The cooling tower, which can be as tall as 200 meters, is where hot water is cooled. In order to easily understand the underlying principles, the following is a description of the most important components of a nuclear power plant that uses a pressurized water reactor, PWR. In the reactor pressure vessel, the nuclear reaction and the associated release of thermal energy takes place. In a pressurized water reactor, as in this case, the reactor pressure vessel stands about 12 meters tall. The walls are about 25 centimeters thick. Inside is where the fuel assemblies can be found. In pressurized water reactors, about 150 such assemblies are installed. A single fuel assembly is composed of many fuel rods. A fuel rod is about 5 meters in length and has a diameter of about 23 centimeters. The actual nuclear fuel is found inside of each fuel rod. Small nuclear fuel pellets composed of enriched uranium or plutonium make nuclear fission chain reaction possible. In the fission chain reaction, thermal energy is released. Water is needed in order to absorb the thermal energy and keep the chain reaction going. Inside the vessel, the water is heated to over 570 degrees Fahrenheit. The water does not boil, however, since the pressurizer maintains the water pressure constant at around 160 bars. The heated water is eventually pumped to a heat exchanger, also called steam generator.
These are typically in the form of a shell and tube heat exchanger. Hot water flows through the U-tubes, heating up the metal of the pipes so that any water inside the heat exchanger begins to boil. The resulting steam is eventually fed through a set of pipes to the turbine building. The steam first drives a high-pressure turbine and then is typically fed to two low-pressure turbines. All of the turbines are connected by a spinning shaft to the electrical generator, which in turn produces AC electricity from the shaft's rotational energy. The steam is converted again into liquid form in a condenser and then returned back to the steam generator. The water needed for this often comes from an adjacent river or is cooled in a cooling tower. The water circulation systems are always kept separate from one another. Water in the primary circulation system never leaves the containment building. This water is radioactive, since it has been in direct contact with the fuel rods. Water in the secondary circulation system is used to drive the turbines and is not radioactive. The cooling circulation system provides cool water and is used to condense the steam in the secondary circulation system.